The name of this video is Viriclé. Problem. Here I intend to summarize the concept of the Dirichlet problem, which we investigated in Physics 242 in order to solve problems, in particular in presence of conductors. As we shall see in 342, we are going to use this concept, this method, also in presence of dielectric materials. For example, when we will study a parallel plate capacitor, which is filled instead of a vacuum, with a dielectric material. So let us consider a universe which is enclosed within this box, which I represent here in two dimensions. So this is my universe, capital Gamma. Within this universe, I consider a conducting material, which we call capital Omega, characterized by an external surface, capital Sigma. This conducting material, capital Omega, is a perfect conductor in macroscopic electrostatic equilibrium conditions. That is, there is no volume charge within this object. There could be a surface charge sigma with density sigma on capital small sigma on capital sigma on the surface of this object. We intend to calculate for any point in space. This point could be either outside the conductor, on the surface of this conductor, or within the conductor. We want to calculate everywhere in space the electrostatic potential V. At any point P, capital P in space. This is what we want to compute. What are the five rules I need to follow in order to compute V? Rule number one of the Dirichlet problem, in particular, this is called an external Dirichlet problem. In Physics 242, we also consider internal Dirichlet problems, which are similar, and we use that concept, that procedure, that method to study electrostatic shields. So the first step of the Dirichlet problem is to use the Laplace equation, which tells us that the scalar Laplacian of V, the electrostatic potential at any point capital P in space, has to be equal to zero. Laplace equation. That is the first step. I will come back in a few minutes about the three cases we consider in 242, which are also the only three cases we are going to consider in 342. More complex cases of this equation are, for example, in books like Jackson, and will be considered in a graduate course level for electromagnetism. The second step of the Dirichlet problem method, so this is a second order differential equation, in general, a partial, a PD, a partial differential equation. Second order, this results in a pair of parameters, alpha and beta, which are unknown and we need to find. So the second condition usually attempts to find this quantity P or to set it, and this is always the case to use this condition in particular when this distribution, this omega, is limited in space, which is the case quite often, of course, in the life, everything is limited in space. So in this case, we want to set our normal conditions at infinity, that is the limit for capital P that goes to infinity of V of capital P has to be equal to zero. And this one usually results in a condition that allows us to set to find beta. The third step of the Dirichlet problem is what is called, what goes under the name of Coulomb's theorem, which has nothing to do with Coulomb's law. We discussed extensively this in 242. Obviously, Coulomb's theorem comes from Gauss's theorem, so it's a consequence of Gauss's theorem. In particular, it's a consequence of case 2 of the local form of Maxwell's equation for the electrostatic field, okay, in presence of conducting materials, C242. So let's remind ourselves a little bit what this Coulomb's theorem tells us and what is the notation we use there. So the limit For a point capital P that approaches a point on the surface from the outside capital sigma. So let's sketch this over here. So if this is my point capital P, I want to approach, this is point, my point capital P here. I want to approach the surface capital sigma from outside. So this is my point capital P over here. Let me sketch it here, not to make mistakes. Point capital P is right on the surface, is right on the surface capital sigma. Whereas this point, I put dot, a dotted line here, this is point capital P plus, that's what we called it. So P plus is a point that in the limit attempts to reach capital P from the outside. So this is P plus, in the limit, eventually it reaches capital P right on the surface, okay? So this is the concept of limit from P to P plus, from the outside. So in this case, this point P plus belongs to this dash surface. And this dash surface, we call it capital sigma plus. This capital sigma plus is another skin, another surface associated with capital sigma. There could be also a minus inside. All the points on capital sigma plus are of P plus type. That is, they are approaching capital sigma from the outside. That is the meaning of this limit, okay? And so since we are considering an integral right after that, it's worth really to define the surface capital sigma plus, because eventually we are not considering a single point, but all the points on this surface when we integrate. And here comes the integral. So we have the integral on the entire surface capital sigma, and I will discuss about this more in detail in a minute. Since E is equal minus the gradient of V, and I want to find something for the potential, I need to remember that there is a minus sign here. The gradient becomes the directional derivative with respect to N of V of P, dA. In the next video, we are going to remind ourselves with an example what this directional derivative actually means, okay? So instead of delving in a theoretical discussion here of what the directional derivative is, go and look at the next video, which is an example where we can clearly see what this derivative actually in real life means. And this quantity, since it comes from Gauss's theorem, it has to be equal to 1 over epsilon naught, the surface integral on capital sigma of sigma dA. And typically here there are two cases. This quantity could be equal to 0 if the conductor was uncharged. Note that locally, sigma is different than zero locally. But globally, when I integrate, if the conductor is uncharged, it's different than zero. Of course, it could be different than zero, that is equal to, let's say, a quantity Q on capital sigma. And we know that a conductor in MeE, Q can only be on capital sigma. In this case, this was true if the conductor was originally charged. Okay? The reason why we have a non-zero local sigma is because we need to expel E within the conductor and we need such a thing. But of course, if the conductor was uncharged, conservation of charge, it has to be still zero, the integral, so the overall sum. Now, this complicated integral, I remind you that the first thing you do, you always do the derivative. See the example we are about to do. And then you do the limit. Also, notation-wise, to simplify a little bit the notation, we use this definition of capital sigma plus, we remove this concept of limit, so this quantity, effectively, can be, in a more compact fashion, be written as minus, and again, minus is because E is minus the gradient of V, and this is nothing but the gradient of V. Surface integral on capital sigma plus, and this definition embeds the limit within it, but you need to do the limit eventually. The gradient, which is the normal derivative of V, PDA, which has to be equal to Q on capital sigma divided by epsilon naught in general. Maybe this can be zero or different than zero, as we specified here. This is Coulomb's theorem. Typically, Coulomb's theorem allows us to find the parameter alpha, the one which multiplies the functional dependence of V with respect to the components of a coordinate system. This is the third step. The fourth step And typically, the third step is where students make mistakes. So this is the one you really want to understand well. The fourth step tells us that the electrostatic potential for each point in the region capital omega union capital sigma, that is everywhere in the conductor, it follows that V upon capital P is equal to a constant. In particular, the fact that this is true on capital sigma means that capital sigma is an equipotential surface. This makes sense because it's a conductor in microscopic electrostatic equilibrium. The last condition, condition number 5, tells us that typically the electrostatic potential V of P is a continuous function for each point in the entire universe capital omega. There are a few exceptions. The exceptions are, for example, the case of an infinite line at the line, approaching the line, there is a discontinuity. The case of a point-like charge. And also the case of a double layer when the width of the layer tends to 0+, which becomes a Helmholtz double layer. We've seen this in 242, and it's basically the model that tells us why the electrons are contained within a conducting material. Except for these cases, which are very specific cases, VP is a continuous function everywhere, which you want to use typically to stitch up if you have multiple regions and you need to stitch up V at different regions. We will see examples in the case of capacitors again in 342, then you want to use this condition here. And also I remind you that obviously the Laplace equation is true only in the vacuum region, that is for each point capital P in the region, the entire universe minus the union of omega with capital omega with capital sigma. Okay, so you want really to use the Laplace equation in the vacuum regions of space. So this is our Dirichlet problem. Now, as I advertised originally in the beginning of this video, I also wanted to say the three special cases we are going to consider in 342, which are the same we consider in 242, for the scalar Laplacian of V. Again, this is in general, is a complicated partial differential equation. We will only consider three cases. The first one is for infinite planes. So if you have infinite planes, where this extends to infinite everywhere, and we consider a Cartesian coordinate system where this one is Z, and this is the origin of the system, the solution to Laplace equation is, in this case, V of Z equal alpha Z plus beta, a linear function. The second case is that of spheres, where this is the origin, this is a spherical coordinate system. In this case, V of R is equal alpha over R plus beta. And the third case is infinite cylinders, where again, this one is the origin, cylindrical coordinate system. This would be the z-axis if you want. In this case, V of R is the most complicated one, is alpha, natural logarithm of R divided by beta. And the reason why we need to have this division by beta is because the argument of the natural logarithm has to be a transcendental function, so it has to be dimensionless. So eventually here, I want meter, and this beta, of course, eventually is also of units meter, okay? So it would be basically, you can also divide it as alpha, natural logarithm of R minus natural logarithm of beta, but I prefer to write it as R divided by beta to remind ourselves that the argument of this logarithm is actually dimensionless. So alpha zeta plus beta, infinite planes. Alpha over R plus beta, spheres, the example to be done in the next video. Alpha, natural logarithm of R over beta for infinite cylinders. So, to recap this video on the Dirichlet problem, very important also in 342, so you really need to master this. If you have a universe within which there is a conducting material in macroscopic electrostatic equilibrium, as always, let's remind ourselves that this is in MEE, already there, but I want to double stress it. The Dirichlet problem is comprised of 5 steps. The first one is to solve Laplace equation in the vacuum region of space. Okay, for example, here, everywhere outside the conducting material. Second, normal conditions at infinity. This typically allows us to find one of the two parameters solving one of these partial differential equations in this particular. These are symmetric cases, therefore they are easy to, it's easy to solve the Laplace equation. Third step, Coulomb's theorem, which tells us in compact form that the minus integral on the external skin, sigma plus, which means in the limit, approaching sigma from outside, of the gradient, which is the direction of derivative of V, has to be equal to Gauss's theorem, if you want, but in general, this is called Coulomb's theorem, it's a subcase, and it was derived by Coulomb, is the total charge divided by epsilon naught, which could be zero or not, depending if the conductor was charged or uncharged originally. For step, we want that capital sigma is an equipotential surface, and the potential is constant everywhere within the conductor as well. And the fifth is to stitch up if you have multiple regions. For example, if there was another conductor somewhere here, and these other conductors, I want to find another somehow a shield or something else. There are multiple regions. If there are multiple regions, then you really want to stitch up the various electrostatic potentials in such a way that the final electrostatic potential is a continuous function, except for the specific cases where it is not continuous. But typically, it is a continuous function. We will use this in the case of capacitors filled with dielectric materials. And the only cases we're going to consider again are infinite planes, spheres, and infinite cylinders, which are all symmetric. Remember the symmetry arguments from 242, where it's simple to calculate the partial differential equation associated with them. And that's it.